Good morning. How's everyone today? I'm so happy to see everyone. You guys look awesome in pink. So if you would like to stand and open your Bibles to Genesis 16, 13. Can I get an amen whenever you got the verse? So it says, "So she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her." I have a different Bible version, but you can follow along. "So she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, 'You are a God of seeing.' For she said, 'Truly here I have seen him who looks after me.'" And today being National Women's Day, the theme is adored by the God who sees me. And sometimes when we're going through troubled times, we can forget that he loves us. We are his children, and we might think that we're going through a trial because we might have done something wrong, or we think that he might turn his back to us, but that's when he's closer than ever. And so God adores us. And today, I just invite everyone to just let that sink into your hearts. Our Father, we learned all the names of God Friday. And it's just amazing the relationship we can have. He's our Father. He's our healer, our comforter. And I just invite y'all to close your eyes and go ahead and pray to start this service. Father God, thank you, Lord Jesus, because you have given us the privilege of being your children. We thank you, God, for everything you do. We know that despite of the troubles, Lord Jesus, you always have the solution, Lord God. We know, Father, that we have a God who sees all things. He sees everything. We just pray, Holy Spirit, that you come into this place, that you touch hearts. And we just pray, Lord God, that all the women today can feel your love and that they can know that you adore them. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for everything you do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless everybody this morning. Isn't it just great to know that we have a God who does see us, a God who's always there for us? And let's just worship him this morning. And you know, in the first song, it says, "Till all we want and all we need is found in you." And it doesn't matter what you're going through, no matter what you need, no matter what you're looking for, you can find it in our Heavenly Father because he sees us and he adores us. Amen. So let's just worship him this morning.
Found it. Your love never fails.
Here in this place this morning, and just the way that his love never fails and that he's never changing, our love for him should be the same. Our love for him should never be changing, but it should grow each and every day as we become more and more aware of who he is and who he is in us. Our love for him should just grow. It's just so comforting to know that we have a Father, and like our theme is a Father who sees us, a Father who adores us. Doesn't matter what you're going through. And this morning, just come before him and just bring him everything you've got. Bring him your best worship. Bring him your praise this morning. Just say, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, for being a God who sees me, a God who I can have a relationship with. And we see other religions to where they don't have a relationship with the God that they serve. It's just a deity, and it's just someone that they worship, but they don't have that relationship, that close and personal relationship. Their God doesn't see them. But we have a God who sees us, and a God who loves us. And that's just all we need, is that Heavenly Father. just worship him this morning. Just lift up your hands and just give him some worship this morning. We worship you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Jesus, you are worthy of all of our praise, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go.
Jesus. And who Spirit leads me on by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Father, we love you so much, Lord. Thank you for your presence here this morning, Lord. You know what we need and when we need it, Lord. Thank you for surrounding us, for just embracing us this morning, Lord, for your sweet, beautiful, wonderful spirit, Lord. You are the God who sees us, Lord, and you not only see us, you love us, you adore us, God. Each and every one of us, Lord, you adored us so much that you willingly gave your life for us, Jesus. Thank you for loving us so much, God. No one can love us the way you love us, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. We thank you. This morning, if you have a need, I'm going to invite you to lift your hand. We will pray for your needs, but I especially ask that you keep my wife in prayer. This past Tuesday afternoon, she was diagnosed with cancer, but we are believing in God. We are trusting in God that He will have His will, His way in her life. Amen. It was pretty devastating, you know, to hear those words, especially when they didn't think that really they only gave her like a 5% chance of having cancer. But well, God knows and God sees, and He loves us so much, and He says, I've got this. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, we love You. We praise and we thank You, God, because You love us so intensely, Lord. You love us, Lord, profoundly, Jesus. And we thank You for that love, Lord. We thank You, Lord, for Your mercy, Jesus. Lord, this morning we come before You, Lord, with heavy hearts, Lord, because there are needs, Lord, and You know, Lord, my prayer request to You, Lord, is for my wife, God. Lord, You know exactly where that cancer is, Lord, and You can eradicate it completely, Lord. We believe in You, Jesus. There is nothing difficult, Lord. There is nothing impossible for You, Lord. And so, thank You, Lord, for taking notice, Lord. And we see Your hand, Lord, how this should not even have been detected yet. But You saw fit, Lord. You made that doctor take a second look, Lord. And You made us take steps, Lord, that we wouldn't have normally taken, Lord. But it was all because You saw what we couldn't see, Lord. What we didn't know, Father, You knew. And we just thank You, Lord. And so we thank You, Lord, that You have already begun the healing process, Lord. We love You and adore You, Jesus. Father, we pray for anyone, Lord, who may be sick this morning, Lord, or praying for a loved one who is sick, or financial need, Lord, or salvation of a loved one, Lord, or in need of some miracle, Lord Jesus. You know when You understand, Father, and so we just place all of our needs in Your hands, and we will thank You, Lord, and we will praise You, Lord. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. You are a good God. If you haven't had an opportunity to bring your tithes and offerings during the praise and worship, we invite you to do so now as we go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank You also for blessing us, Lord, throughout this week, Lord, providing for us once again. And so today, Lord, we bring to You faithfully, cheerfully, Lord, our tithes and our offerings, God. We love You, Lord, and we appreciate You so much. And so we bring these tithes and offerings to You, Lord, and ask that You would bless and be with us, Lord Jesus. Bless Your people. Bless this church, Lord, and multiply this offering in Your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. We want to welcome everyone. If it's your first time, we welcome you, and we hope it's not your last time with us. Amen. Why don't we take a couple of minutes just to greet one another really quickly.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us.
Yes, I am so grateful and joyful. I recognize the love of God in my life because pregnant, I found myself without being married. Rather, I was a slave. Afflicted, I fled from the house of my mistress. But the God who sees everything spoke to me and told me to return because he would take care of my son. It was then that I realized that the God who sees everything saw me too. I am loved by the God who sees me.
Wow, how beautiful is the love of God. I'm Deborah, and I also want to share with you a little bit of my experience. My name in Hebrew means bee. By the love and grace of God, I was able to overcome many barriers. I became a judge and a prophet in the city of Israel, but it wasn't easy. The villages became abandoned, and they became weak until I, Deborah, got up. I got up like the mother of Israel, but if it had not been by the love of God who sees everything, I would have never been able to do it.
Wait, Deborah, I am Ruth, and I also want to express that I've realized the love of God. I was sad. My husband died, and my mother-in-law gave me bad news that she would go alone, and I was set free. So I begged her, I asked her, don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. I recognized that despite of the difficulties, God had the solution. And he who sees all things showed me his great love.
Wait, Ruth, I can't stay without saying what I went through. Hi. I'm Esther, an orphan. I was adopted by my uncle, and I was taken to the palace, to the king's palace, to be elected queen. Despite the adversities, difficulties, and more, God, with his great love, helped me understand that for this time I had came to the palace, that for this time I was chosen. So I took courage and confronted the wicked Haman, who was taken to his own gallows, and my people were set free from his sinister plan.
Wait, I am Anna, and it would not be fair if I were to stay quiet, because there are many women that suffer just like I used to for not being able to bear children. Back then, the days would pass by, and I would just cry and not eat because my heart would hurt, because like I said before, I was not able to bear children. But pouring out my heart to the one who loved me, I cried out. To the Almighty, a child I asked for. And I promised him that I would dedicate him, and that's how I fulfilled it. And then, after a while, he gave me that son I had asked for so long.
That's what I mean, my beautiful ladies. The love of the God who sees everything has manifested in each one of our lives. He is aware of our needs. And today, we can say that he loves us. Yes, he loves us, and he loves you too.
Becky, you are valued.
Appreciated. Syra, you are loved by the God who sees.
And Sonia, you are chosen.
Like a hurricane, I am a tree.
How many of you believe we are loved, we are adored by the God who sees us? Amen. Well, it's my privilege this morning to be able to present you our speaker today. They were directors, her and her husband were directors at Chi Alpha in Arizona, the other U of A. We always joke with them on that, okay? And while they were there, they would take students all over the world on trips. Missions trips, they would always be taking students. And then they, I think you guys have heard of the World Mission Summit. Yeah, we've had quite a few that have gone from here to the World Mission Summit. And then after that, they asked them to become the national Chi Alpha directors in Springfield. And while they're there, I mean, talk about busy people, okay? Then they put Crystal in charge of the network for women ministers. And she's just amazing. So I'd like to ask, but you know what the most important role that she has? Is she's my friend. So I want to present Crystal Martin this morning, and just thank you for worshiping with us. Thank you.
It's true. Pastor Eddie and Becky are dear, dear friends, and your whole church body are dear friends of our family. We really met about 14 years ago when we were here, my husband and I, as part of your missions convention. And I just have to be honest, as we're thinking about loved by the God who sees, I thought, you know, isn't it wonderful that he uses his people to see? And as we have been your missionaries for over 14 years, that you have supported financially, supported by selling your amazing tamales, supported by sending your own children to work with us, you have been the ones that see us. And isn't it awesome that God, he loves us, he sees us, he heals us, and then he invites us into his mission. And as he loved you and healed you and saw you, he invited you into his mission, just as the women we saw today. Yes, he loved them, he healed them, but then he called them. He called them into mission. And God has used your congregation. We tell Pastor Eddie and Pastor Becky often that we received the largest offering we had ever received as missionaries from this district during your missions convention, then and now. So you saw, and there is something about being seen that is powerful. There is something that is being known that's powerful. So thank you for seeing. Thank you for seeing beyond the realm. You see all the flags, and God opens your eyes to the nations when you are invited in to see as he sees. So today, I'm actually going to be... Oh, kids? All right, kids, you could go to children's church. You just make things more fun in here, but. Now, I'm going to ask, is there a PowerPoint by any chance that's, I'll see if that gets us started here. I'm going to give you a little bit about myself as we get started. Oh, I've titled our message, and you will see which character that was up here we're going to be talking about specifically today. What happens under a palm tree can change the world. Thank you, my Deborah. What happens under a palm tree can change the world. All right, go to the next slide here. I'm going to just do a quick introduction. When we were here first, these little boys were tiny. We have two men now. So this was our most recent family event. We had a wedding, and I mean, they would have fit in on this stage right here today. It was perfect. So my younger son, Marcus, who's in the middle, he is 21 years old. He just got married to his high school sweetheart, Molly, who's on his right this summer. And they are both students at Missouri State University, very involved in Chi Alpha, which is exciting. They've gotten involved. They're small group leaders. They're leading trips all around the world. So we're very proud of Marcus and Molly. And the next to them is Mercer. He's my oldest son. I think when we first came here, he was 10 years old. When Stacy spent a summer with us, remember we did Little League Baseball globally, and she was my boy's coach. She was just graduated from high school, and she spent the summer with us, and she became their baseball coach. Who knew Stacy would be such a great baseball coach? They were 10 and 12. Now Mercer is 23. He's actually a law student at WashU in St. Louis, Missouri, and so really interested in religious freedom law. And so God's just opening some really neat, cool doors for him. Kind of has a political bent to him, so we'll just see how God uses Mercer and Marcus, and you have definitely been a part of their journey. If you'll go to the next slide, this is, we talked about the World Mission Summit. Becky, thank you. This church has been a part of every summit, sending students. We're getting ready for our fifth World Mission Summit in St. Louis, Missouri, 2021. Our last World Mission Summit, we had 6,000 students in Houston, Texas. Man, we make a hard call, don't we? Give a year. Pray about a lifetime in mission. It's hard to resist, isn't it? We've spent much of our ministry career saying the Mormons have been giving 2 years, and we have been giving excuses. Who's willing to go? Who's willing to give? Who's willing to pray? And who's willing to welcome the nations? And can I tell you, when we started over or about 20 years ago, started challenging students to give a year and pray about a lifetime, they looked like deer in the headlights. They're like, are you joking me? I'm going to be a pharmacist for the rest of my life. Are you kidding me? You're asking me to give a year and pray about a lifetime? Can I tell you, at the last World Mission Summit, when we had these 6,000 in our audience and we're saying, who's willing to give a year? These are engineers and doctors and lawyers and teachers. Who's willing to give a year and pray about a lifetime of missionary service? Can I tell you, thousands of students like danced to the front because they understand the value of the God who sees them is inviting them into his mission. And there is nothing more important and more powerful than being invited in to God's mission. Amen. All right. Little other piece of, as Becky mentioned, I am the director of the Network of Women Ministers. Cool fact, the Assemblies of God Church, 25% of our credential holders are women. And so we were a movement that was started by women. I mean, in the early Assemblies of God, we were so, I mean, it was so much this kind of prophetic, spirit-filled. It was like, if you said you were called, you were given a mic. Man, woman, boy, girl, whoever it was, it's like, I feel calling, all right, sister, come on up. Let's see what Jesus is doing in and through you. So the church, a little caveat to as part of my role as the director of Network of Women Ministers, I'm also a pastor at Central Assembly of God in Springfield. I work there part-time as associate pastor. And that church, one of our first churches in the Assemblies of God, was started by a woman minister. And so just getting to see what God is doing among our women. And can I tell you, the Latin district in the Assemblies of God are forerunners in seeing women established as lead pastors, as leaders in our movement. And so it's just a very, I feel very humbled that I get to work with this demographic of women and seeing our women. Your Stacy is one of them on the front lines. I don't know if your church knows how in our movement. Who we are, we're an organization mobilizing women to fulfill their ministerial call. I love a church like this that nurtures it from the time we're kids. Could God be calling me into ministry? Could God be calling me to give up things that he's asked of me to step into full-time ministry? He's doing that in this day. Here's what we believe. The image of God is best reflected, and the church of Jesus Christ is healthiest when both men and women are empowered to fulfill their calling at every level of ministerial leadership. We're not about fighting for women's rights. We're about making sure the church is its best. And the church will be its best when men and women work together. The harvest truly is plentiful, isn't it? It's plenteous out there. The laborers are few. We're crying out to the Lord of the harvest that he will send his men, women, boys, girls into the harvest fields. Thank you for BGMC. You're going to be celebrating next week, calling our children into the harvest fields right now. So exciting. Okay, so we are going to be talking about Deborah, and I'm going to ask you to skip this slide and let's go straight to the next one. So this summer I decided I wanted to study the seven prophets of the Old Testament. And there's only seven of them, seven female prophets of the Old Testament. So it's an easy task. There's only seven. So I went to studying. I went to looking at each of them. And some of them have like one scripture verse. So like to try to figure out about Isaiah's wife, I mean, you have to really dig because there's about seven words said about her. And so, I mean, you really have to dig and read and look and figure. But when it comes to Deborah, one of the judges, she was a judge and a prophet in Israel. She has two full chapters devoted to her. Plus, she is considered an author. So she's one of the only very few female authors. So she's just an exciting woman. And I just have to say this about these pictures here. I was in Israel this summer as I was studying these seven women. And I was so excited about Deborah. Like, she was just getting into my life and bones because she was a cool woman. And I'm thinking about Deborah, and I'm like, I want a picture under a palm tree. I want a picture. If Deborah was under a palm tree in Israel, I want a picture of myself because I want a Deborah anointing. And if Elisha can ask for a double point portion, I'm going to get under that palm tree and I'm going to pray that God puts a double portion on me. So here I am on my tour, and I kept asking my tour guide, excuse me, how far are we from where Deborah would have been? He was kind of annoyed at me, actually, because that was not his primary part of this tour, was to find me Deborah's closest location. So finally we're on the tour, and he's like, we're really not going to be exactly where Deborah's palm tree was. And I have to admit, this is not Deborah's palm tree. But I was just, I'm not a real detail person, and so I was like, well, this is kind of close enough. This is by the Sea of Galilee. It's, you know, a few, 50 miles from where Deborah might have been. So I'm like, all right, this is close enough. I'm getting my picture taken under this tree. And I told my husband, who is very sad he is not with you today. He had some other ministry obligations or he would be here. I said, you pray over me that I have this double portion of the Deborah anointing. And she does represent a woman seen by God and invited into his mission. You see, we're not seen and loved by God to just sit on our chair all day, are we? We're seen and loved. And I've worked for many years. This is just a really good example. I worked for many years with international students. And, I mean, is this not an exciting opportunity you have right here at University of Arkansas? Thousands of students coming from all over the world. And we have such an opportunity to reach them with the gospel. But I'll never forget the story of a young girl from Kenya who some Chi Alpha students, Brooke and Rebecca, had really welcomed her into Christian community. And they had, you know, they had taken her to Walmart because international students, you know, they need to buy things and they've never seen anything like Walmart. And you people in Arkansas do Walmart really, really well. So they're like, you're in Arkansas, you gotta get to Walmart. So they had taken this young Kenyan girl to Walmart. They had taken her some American restaurants. They took her to a church service. They're trying to show her American culture, introducing her to Jesus. And then this Kenyan girl is telling the story of how welcomed she felt, how loved she felt by the people in Chi Alpha. She said, my life was transformed by the love that I felt from these people. Because, you know, we can be God's extension into the world, right? So she was feeling the love of the church, the love of his people. But she said, I knew I was part of community, that I was really the friends of Brooke and Rebecca when they asked me to help them. You see, friendship is mutual. And there is something we say, we are a friend of God. He loves us. He sees us. But this young Kenyan woman said, when Rebecca and Brooke asked me to come and help move them out of their apartment, I knew at that point that I was really their friend. Because it wasn't just what they give to me. It was what I got to give back to them. And then I knew we were friends. And there is something, friends, the God who sees us, there is such a deep level of friendship that says, I don't just see you, but I'm going to invite you. I'm going to invite you to come and bring my kingdom. You are my conduits into this world. I am inviting you into this, into my mission. And that, my friends, is what Deborah is going to show us today. Now, before we even get to Deborah, I'm watching my clock. I want to frame our story of Deborah from a New Testament principle. And so before we get there, I want us to look at Acts 2:17, a very common passage. And in the last days it shall be, God declares. So this is Peter sharing this after the day of Pentecost. We're in Acts 2:17. That I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Even on your male servants and female servants. In those days I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. Peter comes out after this fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. He grabs the mic of that day. I'm not sure what it was, a megaphone, a stand on a high temple, something. He stood up and he began to proclaim, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Friends, today as we are sitting together in this beautiful place in Arkansas, beautiful church surrounded by flags, this is the last moment there has ever been on this earth. We are celebrating it right now together. And it is saying in the last day, he is pouring his spirit out on all flesh. My friends, that must mean us. If it means anyone, it means us. He is pouring out his spirit on all flesh. The interesting thing is this scripture really could have ended right there. Peter could have just got up, quoted Joel, in the last days, I'm pouring out my spirit on all flesh. And all flesh really means all flesh, right? All humans. But the problem with humans is we quickly exclude people because of our power structures in our culture. So it was very important that there was a denotation of what all flesh meant, men and women. I'm pouring my spirit out on all men and women. Doesn't really matter what your power structures are of the day. I'm going to be pouring my spirit out on all flesh, all men and women. I'm going to be pouring my spirit out on the young and the old. When Peter said this the first time, actually the second time, quoting the prophet Joel, there was a lot of discrimination, of age discrimination. You weren't going to speak if you were young. But he said, I'm going to pour my spirit out on both the old and the young. It really doesn't matter what the power structures of the day. I'm going to be pouring my spirit out on the old and the young. And even it goes to the next verse. It says, even the maidservants, men and women, even the lowest class in society, I'm going to be pouring my spirit out. And you can just almost imagine how this had to rock the thoughts of the power structures of the day, where you were really not allowed to speak honestly until you were an old man. Those were the people that had the power to speak in that culture. Do you know, in our culture, it's a little different. I'd say we have a more of an age discrimination. I work with old at the church I attend, there are very many retired ministers and missionaries who the power of God is so powerful on them, but they have lost their voice in this culture. And can I tell you, there's pain associated about that, with that. But Jesus is saying, God is saying, I'm pouring my spirit out on all flesh. It doesn't matter. And so here we are standing saying, God, pick me, right? Pick me. Let me be the one that is your mouthpiece. Let me be the one. Pour out your spirit on all flesh. And then very soon after that, so you have Peter, I'm pouring my spirit out on all flesh. Then we go a few chapters later in Acts, and we get to the story of Cornelius. Because yes, I'm pouring my spirit on all flesh, but at this point, Peter could not imagine they meant the Gentiles. Really? The Gentiles too? And then one day, he was really hungry because it was noon. And you know, Holy Spirit comes when we're hungry. Hungry might be a sign that, let Lord, give me a vision. So he's hungry, it's noon, and all these strange animals appear, and this voice comes and says, go eat. And he's like, no, I would never touch anything unclean. There's no way. God said, take, eat. Anything I've made is clean. And then through that series of events, through this vision, a Gentile who Jews did not interact with, he was invited into a Gentile home, and in that Gentile home, he preached the gospel. They were filled with the Holy Spirit, the men, women, boys, girls, even to the ends of the earth. And Peter, if we go to the next scripture, then they heard these things. They fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also? Wow, this is really coming on all flesh. And at that point, they had a revelation of what all flesh, I am pouring my spirit out on all flesh, men, women, boys, girls, even the Gentiles. Friends, that's all of us. And so I said all of that to say, bottom line, let's go to the next slide. There is no such thing really as an extraordinary Christian. Now, I've put these two folks on the screen because for the 20th century, I think we would probably look at Billy Graham and Mother Teresa and say they've done more for Christendom than anyone did in that century. Billy Graham being the proclaimer of the word, Mother Teresa showing us how to love through our hands, the people of the world. And I remember my mom about 5 years ago saying, Crystal, my mom's incredible woman of God, pastor's wife. She said, Crystal, who's going to be the new Billy Graham? Who's going to be? We've got to have a new Billy Graham. And I was like, Mama, I don't know what Jesus is doing, but he's pouring his spirit on all flesh. Friends, I feel like what the Lord is saying in our generation is let's not necessarily look for a Mother Teresa or a Billy Graham. Let's not look for a hero. Let's be a hero. Because he is pouring his spirit out on all flesh. And there are no ordinary Christians. If you are following Christ, if you have said yes, there's nothing ordinary. You are a child of the Most High God. You are his sons. You are his daughter. He is inviting you into his mission. And so we don't need to look for extraordinary people to do extraordinary things. We need to own that every one of us is extraordinary. Every one of us is called to be a Billy Graham to our sphere of influence. Every one of us is there to touch the people around us. Because seen by the God who loves, guess how the world is going to see his love? It's through you. You are the ones that are going to be the conduit from the God who loves to the world. But friends, don't look for someone else to do it. He is calling each of us. I want us to frame our look at Deborah from that lens because I don't want us to look at Deborah as some extraordinary person with some extraordinary call. In the Old Testament, there were few prophets. Today, he's pouring his spirit out on all flesh. So I need us to look at Deborah through the lens of every man and every woman. So here we go. We're coming to Judges 5, chapter 7. Now, Deborah, thank you for those who did the play today. We had a Deborah with us. Now, Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel at this time. I'm so sorry. I just realized we were on the wrong scripture. We're going to go to Judges 4, 1 through 3. Sorry, I confused our folks up there. And the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord after Ehud died. This is a very common place for the people of Israel during the time of the judges. I believe it happened 13 times. It was a cycle of apostasy, sometimes repentance and deliverance. So here they were doing evil again. And the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan. Here's the deal, friends. Our heart is more important than our comfort. And so God cared more about the heart of his people than the comfort of his people. He sold them into the hand of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazar. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Heroish Hagoyim. Then the people of Israel cried out to the Lord for help, for he had 900 chariots of iron, and he oppressed the people of Israel cruelly for 20 years. So you had a cruel king, a cruel army leader who was pushing down the people of Israel cruelly. Now, I did ask when I was Israel, what would have this meant for the people of Israel? They actually had fled to the high country, so there was starvation because you could only farm and have your sheep in the low country. So there was very little food for their sheep. There was very little place for them to farm. They were being cruelly oppressed, and at that point, they began to cry out to the Lord. These 900 chariots was actually the highest level technology in all the world at that time. Iron was new, and so it would be like the stealth fighter pilots of the day compared to like a bow and an arrow, okay? That is literally what the people of Deborah's army might have had against stealth fighter pilots. I want you to see the discrepancy between the power base of the Israel army and the power base of the Canaanite army. So in that season of apostasy, of oppression, we get to Judges 4, 4 through 5. Now, Deborah. Insert your name right there, because Deborah wasn't any more extraordinary than you are. Now, Crystal. I'll insert my name. A prophetess. Now, Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel at the time. Now, the role of the judge as the leader, she wasn't just judging marriage disputes. I mean, it wasn't like the Jewish people were like, he was mean to me. No, she was mean to me. No, let me figure out who was really the meanest and judge and send you off on your way. The role of the judge was to bring the hearts of the people who were very far from God back to God, because she was using the law to make her judgments. And so people who had become very far off in idolatry and worshiping the things of the earth, just like what's happening around us, the apostasy that's happening around us, her role was to move the people from apostasy, from being far, far from God. She was moving her people closer, closer to God. One thing I love about Deborah, and I think there will be some extraordinary people in this church, Deborah didn't have a lot of models. She was the first female judge. And there are times in our life where we are called out to do something that really nobody before us has done, that we haven't seen before. Deborah had never seen a female prophet, but God, a female judge, but God called her out. My colleague, who is from Kenya, he said, we need models to give example and permission, but sometimes models do not exist. And when that happens, when God calls you to do something, Mary, the mother of Jesus, really didn't have a model. Nobody told her how to raise the Messiah. Nobody's done it before, and nobody's done it after. And so the importance of walking where God has called us to walk, that is what Deborah, the prophetess, did. She stood up as the mother of Israel and said, pick me, I will be the one, pick me. And she stood up and led her people. It was under that palm tree that she honed, and this is what my extraordinary people, she honed her listening ear and her speaking voice. And each of you, as extraordinary, loved by God, you need to find your palm tree out there in the world, and you need to hone your listening ear. God, what are you saying to the people around me? What do you want me to speak? Maybe it's your gym. I have a really good friend who started a Bible study in her gym. That's become her palm tree. She's honing her listening ear and her speaking voice. And so when a few verses later we find out Deborah goes to Barak and says, call the armies, we're ready to go. God is going to deliver us. You see, she, Deborah, was a judge that was ready. And I know Pastor Eddie, as I've been talking to, yesterday evening, we're getting ready for a building project. God's calling us into something new in this congregation. Just like Deborah, it's like, it's ready. We're ready for something new. Deborah was ready. Why was she ready? Because she had a palm tree. And under that palm tree, she honed her listening ear. She honed her speaking voice. So when it was time to call in the armies, Deborah and the armies were ready. Was Samson ready? Nope. Was Gideon ready? Nope. Deborah was ready. So, as we're moving forward, I want to look at a few takeaways from our message this morning. First of all is this. There are no ordinary Christ followers. Please do not look for a hero. Stand up and be one. Because that is the only way this world is really going to be reached. A good friend of ours, Randy Hurst, who's a fantastic missiologist in our movement, he said recently that the places that are going to be reached by a pulpit have already been reached. We have to have people that are willing to go to the highways and byways of this world and make a palm tree and turn it into a beachhead of ministry, where we move the people in the world far from God closer to him. Where is your palm tree? Don't look for a hero. Are you ready to step into a place you've never been before and where no one else is showing the way? There might be my friend who started a Bible study in her gym. She had really never seen that done. But as she began to be a light, her kids were in the preschool classes. You know, a lot of gyms have like kids programs. So she'd put her kids in the kids programs. She'd work out for an hour, and then she started a Bible study right there for seekers, people that weren't in church and were just curious about how her life was different. She made a beachhead right in her gym, a palm tree, where she was really acting as a judge, moving the hearts of people that were far away from God closer to God. Isn't it amazing that we can be his eyes to the world? Ask the Lord, where is your palm tree? Where are you growing your listening ear and speaking voice? Where are you drawing this apostate world, closer to God? I'd love our worship team to come, or just even our piano. Guess what? Deborah and the army won. There was a great victory. And one of the things I love about in the end, so she won, she wrote this beautiful poetic poem about the victory, and she rises up and she says, I rose up as the mother of Israel. I loved that she used the word mother to describe a war victory. How fantastic is that? She rose up as a mother of Israel. And I think the Lord is saying to us, rise up, O mothers, rise up, O fathers. Ask the Lord, where is my beachhead? Where is my palm tree? Where are you wanting to hone my listening ear and my speaking voice? Because you are inviting me into your mission. You are inviting me to be your hands, your eyes, your feet. Rise up, O mothers. Rise up, O fathers. Today, I'm going to ask you to rise up. Rise up, O mothers. Rise up, O fathers. Deborah was never a physical mother, but she was a spiritual mother as she led her people into victory. We already have victory because Jesus did it at the cross. But we want to lead our generation to the cross where they can find their victory. And I'm going to ask you this morning whether you want to come forward as an act of saying, you could even move into the aisle to say, yep, I'm ready to rise up. I am ready to be led by Deborah. I am ready to rise up and say, yes, I'm going to look for my palm tree. Yes, I am going to be God's eyes. Yes, I am going to be his voice. Yes, I am going to hone my listening ear. Yes, I am going to hone my speaking voice. And I just want you to consecrate yourself one more time to the Lord, that as he loves you and sees you, you are saying yes to his mission. You are saying yes to his work in your life. You're saying yes to step into places that you've never even thought of. You're saying yes to asking God, what are those new places you are asking me to go? You are saying yes. I'm going to pray over you. You know, Deborah, when she said, I rose up, she celebrated what God had done in and through her. Part of saying yes is celebrating the yeses you've had in your past and asking God to give you more yeses in your future. Thank you, God. I'm going to pray over you, and then I'm going to pass it over to the pastors to dismiss us this morning. Father God, I thank you for the many yeses of the people that are here this morning. They said yes to get up and come to church this morning, saying yes to your ways, saying yes to your plan, saying yes to your destiny. Father, the people that are here today have said many yeses. God, I pray that you give them hundreds of more yeses in their mouths. God, I pray that you show them the palm tree where you are honing their influence, Lord, that you are honing their listening ear to listen to your ways, to your voice, that you are honing their speaking voice, Lord. God, pour out your spirit afresh on each of us, Lord Jesus, your sons, your daughters, your men, your women, your old, your young. Let us receive one more time, Lord Jesus. Let us receive one more time the filling of your Holy Spirit, Lord God, to do the mission you have called each of us to, Lord Jesus. Let us step in greater ways to that destiny that you have called us to, Lord.